Hello and welcome to episode 71 of The Garden Log with me, Ben Dark. I am a gardener and this is a gardening podcast. I am broadcasting to you from late November. My fingers have now warmed up just about enough to turn on the laptop, to plug in the microphones and twiddle the various dials that come with recording a podcast. It has been cold. It has been muddy. At one point this week, I felt like crying because everyone else in the team got made a cup of tea, and I didn't get made a cup of tea. And in these days of cold and close darkness, cups of tea really are beacons that keep the gardener going. Anyway, this podcast is not about my personal woes. This podcast is about my triumphs, my successes, my adventures in horticulture. And this week I have been adventuring with martagon lilies, planting 300 big, fat, waxy lily bulbs to cause a summer riot in June and July. I've also been spreading mulch quickly, hurriedly, with a soundtrack of curses. And I have also been clearing up leaves. You will not be surprised to hear that you might learn some interesting leaf-clearing techniques from this episode. Many people seem to think the gardeners slow down at this time of year, but I feel busier than I have been for months. It's almost out of control, the amount of jobs that need to be done. So enough of this introduction. Let's get on and hear the week in gardening. Welcome to the week in gardening. A week that began on Monday in the hellish cold and wet. The rain has now been falling solidly for months, and we're into that time of year where wet will now hang around. The days of drying sun, the days of transpiration, the days of trees pumping water out of the ground with their great leaf mass are over. What we have now will be our companion for the months to come. It's a pain, a real pain. On Monday, it was specifically a pain because we were collecting lots and lots of leaves. These are leaves on the lawn. And leaves on the lawn really must be collected because they kill off the grass and they lead to all sorts of problems underneath. So they needed to be got out of the way. And normally, at a time like this, you can use various tricks. You can blow the leaves vaguely into a long line and then send your ride-on mower up the line, hoovering it up like a rock star cleaning his coffee table. But we can't do this when the ground is wet because the ride-on mower is just going to sink deep into the mud and make a horrible, horrible mess. Not necessarily when it's going in the straight line, chopping up all the leaves and taking them up, but when you turn it, it tends to mash and mulch and skid and slide. I tried a little bit of the similar technique using our billy goat machine. The billy goat machine, for any of you who aren't aware, is a vast industrial vacuum cleaner on wheels. It's horrendous, by far the loudest machine in the garden. But it's got a blade inside it, and you can run it over the top of piles of leaves and hoik them up through the chopping blades to a collecting bag on the back. But even that was lining the lawn deeply. So it really is just a case of blowing them into piles, using nothing heavier than the gardener, his feet and his backpack blower, putting them into piles and then raking them up and scooping them into dumpy bags, into those ton bags that the builders' merchants deliver things in. The technique that I'm using at the moment is to use the leaves' weight against them to build a pile of leaves deep enough that you can slide the rake underneath it as if it were a snow shovel, then pick the rake up, load it high with leaves and dump them straight into the bag. This of course works because everything is completely sodden, which means the leaves have a little bit of structural integrity. They are bound to each other by the wetness that keeps us miserable. It also means that the leaves don't blow out from the borders, which is something of a blessing, The leaves there are stratifying. They are forming dense, cakeish layers. Each time a leaf falls, it gets wetted and stuck to those below it, which means they aren't hopping about the place and turning up on the lawn again. They're staying in the beds, and some of them, if they stay there, will just be buried in place. I'll stick a load of mulch on top of them, and they can be an extra layer of organic material for those beds. So there is some relief in the wet. It isn't just horrendous, soul-sucking negatives. After the leaf morning, I started planting some bulbs. Our bulb orders have now overlapped. One of these situations where some jobs haven't been done and other jobs are arriving. So I still have all of the tulips and scilla to plant. Thousands and thousands of those. And then 300 huge martagon lily bulbs turned up. Martagon lily are those wonderful lilies, the Turk's cap lilies. Those lilies that grow in the semi-shade with beautiful reflexed petals. And I've got 300 of those to go in various shady, semi-wild bits of the garden. I was anticipating them turning up in spring, which is normally when I'd plant a lily bulb, but now they're here, and they jump to the top of the queue because they are waxy and tender and look uncomfortable hanging around on the wooden shelving where the other bulbs are living quite happily in their compact and globular form. A lily bulb, if you haven't seen one dug out of the ground, looks nothing like a tulip or a daffodil. It looks a lot like a head, an artichoke head, a globe artichoke head with all of those little scaly petals that you rip off and dip into melted butter and garlic. The lily scales are white and waxy, and they have a yellowish tinge, like an onion that has been roughly chopped and fried lightly in ghee and turmeric. That's what they look like to me. And so I've been taking those out. I started to plant them. I got them all set out, lined up like landmines on the top of this area of semi-shade where they're going to go in. And it was about 2:30. The end of the day was fast approaching, the light fading, and then suddenly the beep of a reversing articulated lorry pierces the garden. And you realise, oh no, there's 3 tons of mulch turned up and it's blocking an access route and it needs to be shoveled off. So the lilies were all gathered back up again, thrown willy-nilly onto the racks, and I ran out with wheelbarrow and shovel to desperately get rid of this compost, this mulch. It was a very aggressively energetic finish to the first day of the working week. Night fell as I was washing the last of the mulch away from driveways and paths with a hose pipe. It's a wonderful demonstration of the elasticity of hours in the gardening day. I don't know how long the hour and a half that I spent clearing leaves up in the morning was, but it must have been at least 4 or 5 or 6 times as long as the hour and a half that I spent clearing mulch at the end of the day. Anyway, my lesson not learned. I spent Tuesday morning clearing more leaves. This is clearing the very leathery old sweet chestnut leaves from a huge lawn specimen. Sweet chestnut leaves are some of the toughest leaves in the garden. They seem tougher than leathery old plane leaves, tougher than oak leaves, far tougher than horse chestnut leaves. Horse chestnut leaves don't come close. They go ragged and tissue paper and flake away and fall to pieces. But sweet chestnut leaves stick around. They're also very jagged and serrated. So they tend to cling to each other like stickle bricks, which means they will stay pleasantly in one place. It's very easy to go and round them up, to corral them, and send them off to their leaf mould bays or their various compost heaps. So I started Tuesday doing that. Then I repaired some damage to one of the wisterias. We got a standard wisteria, a wisteria that's grown in a tree form, and it had come loose from its bracing pole. Wisterias are not, by nature, designed to grow as a tree. They're designed to grow as a climber, which means they need some sort of stout support, at least in the first 10 or 15 years of their life. This wisteria's pole had rotted at the ground, which meant the whole thing had done a horrendous back flop. The wisteria was in the position that a limbo dancer might be in if the dancer had attempted a bar just one notch too low and had toppled backwards, so the back of the dancer's head was resting upon the floor, and all the crowd were booing them off. This is what the wisteria was doing, and we didn't boo it off. We rehabilitated it, stood it upright, replaced the rubbish old pole, and put in something far more substantial. I found a 3-meter-long length of scaffolding pole, which is that wonderful versatile thing that scaffolders use to clothe their buildings in, to clothe most of central London in, it seems, at the moment. And I spray-painted that a fetching sort of brown, inoffensive brown colour, to make it look like a less gunmetal, instantly recognisable scaffold pole. I don't mind people knowing, oh, there's a metal pole holding your wisteria up. I'd just rather they didn't know, oh, there's a scaffolding pole holding your wisteria up. So I whacked that in with a sledgehammer. It's very good fun, standing on top of a stepladder, on top of a bench, with a sledgehammer, whacking this scaffolding pole down. And now the wisteria has a perfect companion pole that should last it for hopefully 50 or 60 years, until the two of them have grown together and there is just this pole at the heart of the wisteria, and some other gardener, 10 gardeners hence, will come along and say, my God, I need to get rid of that, and chainsaw it down and blunt his tool horrendously and curse me to the heavens and talk about it on his podcast, no doubt, but that's something for the future. For now, it will stand strong and tall. The best of these wisteria sports, you find, are the custom-made ones, the custom wrought iron umbrella-like things that you see in Regent's Park, in the secret garden in the centre of Regent's Park. There are some good examples. We don't have those, so scaffold poles, it shall be. It was an absolutely horrible day on Tuesday. Some of you are probably out gardening in it, and then you'll remember. It was cold and gloomy and windy and wet. A wind that contained little razor blades of rain. And when it didn't contain razor blades of rain, it was almost colder and crueler. It was more able to get into any crack and crevice in the gardener's armour. I actually felt it around my toes. I felt it blowing through the hole in the toe caps of my steel toe cap boots I've worn through in a couple of places, and I could feel the wind swirling around. I felt a bit like a penguin separated from my colony. Never mind, I planted more martagon lilies. These ones I'm planting to flower in the long grass around a light stand of birch trees. And I think that'll look really good there. I know that martagon lilies are normally planted as a sort of woodland plant, as a sort of put them in the semi-shade as an exciting bulb for early summer, because God, nothing else is going to flower there. But I suspect, like most of these things, they're actually going to be better in a sunnier aspect. And this is a slightly sunnier position. They'll flower, hopefully, at about 4 foot. So they'll look good going just above the long grass, and then with those light waving birch leaves behind them, it could be a really exciting area of the garden. This is a bit of the garden that I've been talking about recently. We planted the birch in there earlier this year. We're clearing it, reclaiming it from bracken, and I've been using the bracken technique of just whipping off the little croziers, the little bracken heads, as they unfurl themselves from the ground. And it was a really good lesson in how futile this practice has been. Those bracken roots down below are fantastically strong and healthy. They are clothed in this black outer stem, and all strong and fleshy and succulent beneath. They really seem just happy and vigorous, and I've been battling them every single week without fail. I feel the approach that I'm taking might be slightly ineffectual. It's sort of like trying to starve your enemy to death by stealing one forkful of his food at every mealtime. It might work over the course of a lifetime, but gosh, what a long life it might be. Anyway, that was the end of Tuesday. On Wednesday, I carried on cleaning up. I cut back some zinnias, some of those last of the summer annuals, which was quite exciting. It's absolutely amazing, the thickness of a zinnia stem. Things that it grows in just a year. Real tree trunk stuff. You can see how biologically hard it must be for plants to put on proper hardwood, proper secondary thickening wood, compared to just first year growth, because the amount you can do as an annual in a year really is impressive. Anyway, those are gone. They're out the way. I cut back the flower, Japanese anemones, and some of the crocosmia that had started to go in all sorts of sort of horrible directions. You know, the style of Japanese animation, the ones with the manga hair, where all of the characters have these incredible haircuts that go in all sorts of different directions, peaks and angles and extremities, like crystals coming up. That's what the crocosmia is starting to look like as it falls over and starts looking shaggy and horrible. So that's all gone, all cut out. It was another very cold day on Wednesday. I was cycling home and I found a loquat in flower. I was doing the second part of my commute home once I've cycled to my little branch line station, then gone into Marylebone. I cycled through Belgravia, and sometimes I need supplies in Belgravia, so I stop in this little Waitrose somewhere between the German embassy and the Pakistani High Commission, in that little part of the embassy town world, the bit that I told you about with all those dead box balls in the windows. Anyway, this Waitrose has an incredible pot display, and in that pot display are four or five fantastic loquats in flower. And I think that if any loquats are going to fruit in London this year, these will be they, because they're in this beautiful heat island. They are bombarded by heat from the sliding motion sensor doors to Waitrose. They are sheltered and cosseted. So I hope, I'm going to chart them every week, that I might be able to get some loquats from that, plucked from the streets of London. That'd be quite exciting. Anyway, Thursday I didn't go into the garden. I was doing my garden history masters. I was in the British Library hunting for the London County Council municipal gardening policies of 1889. Quite exciting. It was actually very funny. I found a conversation that I recognise from horticultural debates that we have nowadays. This was the general board of the London County Council, the commissioners who'd been elected, and they were talking about setting up a dedicated landscape department to run all of the parks, the ever-expanding parks of London, with a proper superintendent. And this superintendent was to be paid £700 per year. And they all agree this is a very good thing. And the motion was ready to be put to the council when someone stuck their hands up and added an amendment saying, actually, 700 quid, that's a bit much. I know some jolly good gardeners who'd do it for less. Well, actually, yes, now you say it. I think there'd be chaps at Kew who would bite at the chance. They'd do it for 400. Motion passed, we'll pay them 400. And you think, no, you commissioners, why do you do this? Why do you take the gardeners' money? Anyway, that made me chuckle. Some things never change. On Friday, I went back into work, cycled back in the other direction, up through Belgravia, up through Hyde Park. It's quite exciting in Hyde Park at the moment. They're building their vast theme park they do every winter, the Winter Wonderland. And so I see it twice a day. And I have, it's much like the leaf collecting / mulch distribution in the evening. Something that is objectively the same, it really, really changes depending on where you're viewing it from. So in the morning, I cycle past this Winter Wonderland and I get very curmudgeonly and I look at the magpies emerging from the mist and the low-lying water vapour and the sun just coming up between the trees, and I think, here is your Winter Wonderland. It is here. It's here in the green and the grass and the dew and the frost. And then on the way home, I cycle through it in pitch black, in completely inky darkness, with various joggers all lit up like little Christmas trees popping out of the gloom. And then suddenly these vast roller coasters and rides and spiraling lights look welcome and hearty and enticing, and a bit of human fight against the gloom, something necessary, an injection of fun to inoculate us little Northern Islanders against the coming chill. So I enjoy seeing that each day and charting my own reaction to it. Maybe I should actually go this year and experience it from the inside. Anyway, more leaves on Friday, great big piles of them again, snow rake technique, into the bags, blah, blah, blah. I also pulled out some of the poor remnants of the summer bedding. I pulled out this sad, half-frosted New Guinean patience from the mixed planting area. And there's no more gruesome a barrow than these poor benighted things. This is Impatiens horcari, the very lovely garden, fleshy plant that they've got there. And when they've been frosted, they lose their leaves and they just leave these stems standing up, these fat little tubelets. They're sort of chubby and necrotic, and they're in lurid shades of green and purple, shading to brown. They look like a barrow full of weird bits of flesh when you take them off to the compost heap. That was quite exciting to collect all of those off and dump them down, and then spread the area they'd been with more cheerful, with more pleasant little pansies and violas, and let the area get into its winter finery, much like Hyde Park is doing at the moment. And that was it, at the end of another week in gardening. They go too quickly. We are rushing through the year. If we close our eyes, there will be daffodils and primroses everywhere. I think we should hold on to this November misery for a little bit. Right, that's enough of late November seasonality. Let's get on and see if I have any recommendations this week. Just one recommendation this week, something to while away the dark nights while the wind whistles down the chimney. That is getting a magazine targeted at the country set. Get a copy of Country Life or Field magazine. Field magazine is the magazine which tells you how to train your gun dog and takes pictures of the social pages that Lord Jeffrey whatever's shoot. If you want a window into another world, it's worth reading anyway. But all of these places have all these adverts in the front and middle and back. So you do wonder why you pay this £4.90. But anyway, these adverts tend to be for grand, slightly dishevelled country houses. And you can play a fun game of spotting how poor gardening is amongst the seats of our aristocracy. Most people don't really have any gardens. They have a massive, massive drive and some shrubs and a bit of yellowing lawn. And you can search through and see who has actually thought about their garden. And then you can play a game with yourself. How would I do this? How would I make this into the best garden in England? How would I make this into the best garden that has ever existed? And you can spend hours squinting and turning it and thinking about things. And I think it gives me ideas about the garden I work with, because you make the most bold and brilliant suggestions when it's someone else's estate. And then you think to yourself, well, maybe actually I should consider our own approach in that way. Maybe we don't have the right picture of gardenness for someone stepping out onto the terrace. Maybe I should look at my own garden as if it were being photographed by a drone for an upmarket estate agents. Just an idea. I'm sure there are lots of websites as well where you can go and look at properties by acreage and see just how lacking in great gardens we are at the moment. It's those damn committee men negotiating down the gardener's wages. That's what the problem is. Anyway, go and have a look at that. And if you don't feel like it, then fine, do what you like. Until next week, I hope that you have a wonderful time, whether you're gardening or not. I hope you manage to stay warm, and I hope you manage to stay dry. And I really do hope that those of you have been flooded out. I've been talking quite flippantly about the rain and the problems it's caused me, but I know that there are people whose businesses, whose livelihoods, or just the spaces they love have really been affected. And if that's you, I'm really, really sorry to hear it. You have my complete sympathy. To you and everyone else, thank you very much for listening, and goodbye.